The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron.
Hello and welcome to the Big Scottish Football Podcast with me, Stephen Mill, and him, Ewen Cameron. And he's just about come back down to earth after two brilliant results for Hearts over the last few days.
And before we talk about our weekend, let's put on a fashion show.
Okay.
So those of you who are watching the podcast on YouTube will see that I have on my head a Hearts baseball cap. There's the Hearts badge is on the middle of the baseball cap, celebrating what has been a brilliant week for Heart Midlothian Football Club. 7 goals scored in 2 games through the next round in Europe and into the next round of the League Cup as well after pumping Partick Thistle 4-0, which we'll get to in just a second. But for those of you who are not watching on YouTube, so I've got that on my head. And underneath this tracksuit top of mine, I would like to reveal to you, Stephen Mill, and also to producer John, who's in the other part of the building, is I've got the new Hearts jersey on. Look at that absolute beauty of a shirt. It's the Hearts third strip. It's a 150th anniversary top, and it cost me £55. So look at that. Isn't it good?
You're such an odd man. You really are such an odd man.
Do you like the top, though?
I mean, it's quite nice, to be fair. Yeah, it's quite nice. I mean,
I'd like to get the badge.
I'm not a Hearts fan, so
there you go. So yeah, it's been a great week, and we had a brilliant weekend, didn't we, mate?
It was good. Yes, we were out at the Edinburgh Fringe on Saturday night. Yes. So
we worked on the big Saturday football show on the Saturday afternoon, two till six, and then at 6 o'clock we met up with our partners.
Yep.
Your wife Anna, my wife Teresa, and we met up with Kat Harvey, who I work with on The Breakfast Show on Greatest Hits Radio, and producer Kat, who produces The Breakfast Show.
The two cats.
And we went to a bar and a restaurant called
The Alchemist.
The Alchemist. And it's the first time I'd been.
Yeah.
And the reason that that place was chosen is because my wife and Kat like cocktails.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a really good choice of venue.
I thought it was excellent, yes.
The food was lovely. I had chicken in a basket with regular fries and had a honey glazed spicy dip with it. Beautiful. Succulent bits of chicken.
I was so hungry by the time we ate. You know, same. I inhaled my food.
I turned round. I'd only eaten one breast of chicken and your food was gone.
Yeah. I like it. If there's something on my plate and I'm hungry,
it's gone.
It doesn't last very long.
And it was a very quiet table during the food. And then we washed that down with a zombie apocalypse.
Yeah.
And then I felt a wee bit whiffy. No, whiffy's not the right word. What does whiffy mean?
Whiffy means smelly. So
no, it wasn't smelly.
You weren't smelly. I mean, I would love to say that you were smelly, but you weren't smelly. You were feeling a wee bit sort of woozy.
Woozy, that's the word, because I'm not a drinker.
No.
I'm more a lover than I'm a drinker, but I had a few cocktails and a couple of beers and had a brilliant night. I got the last train home, but I left you outside.
Yes.
At the Edinburgh Fest. So what time did you leave?
I got home at 2:30.
Not bad going, actually, because Edinburgh Festival was on till 5.
That was open till 5, the bar we were in. So I'm really glad we didn't end up there until 5 a.m. And I went to see Oppenheimer yesterday, which is very good if you haven't seen it yet.
It's a 3-hour movie.
But didn't feel like it was 3 hours.
Were you not hungover?
Absolutely flew by. No, it wasn't too bad, actually. I was fine. I wasn't too bad.
So you'd recommend it despite the 3-hour length?
Despite the 3-hour length, I would say Oppenheimer is the best film that I've seen in quite a long time.
Oh, brilliant.
I thought it was great.
I'm really keen to see that. So I might go and watch that. But I think 3 hours is quite a long time to sit in a cinema.
So, lots of comments on the show last week. You can always get them in on @BigFootballScot on Twitter, on Instagram and Facebook. Just search for the Big Scottish Football Podcast. Or you can go to YouTube, just search for Clyde on Superscoreboard and you'll see the full podcast. Or not quite the full podcast last week. Because obviously, as soon as I got to the conspiracy bit, it just sort of blanked out.
It was a black screen.
Yeah.
You could hear us, but you couldn't see us. And the conspiracy online is that somebody interfered with the show for a reason and they want to know what actually was going on here in the studio for the screen to go black at that particular point. Some have suggested that aliens interfered with us. Some have suggested that John actually did streak through the studio.
I got loads of tweets off the back of last week's episode about the moon landings as well. So thanks very much for that.
So we're going to get it.
And it was these fake videos put together where Buzz Aldrin was like, no, we didn't land on the moon. And it's like, no, he didn't say that. Like, you know, and then it actually came up with, like, you know, on Twitter, it has the sort of like
disclaimer.
A disclaimer, like, this is a fake video. So anyway, lots of comments about the conspiracy last week. Hearts bottled it, end of. That is the sort of chat that is coming on YouTube in terms of the comments as well. Garvey didn't try a leg. Once and for all, watch the full game, says James Morton.
Because of the conspiracy we talked about last week.
Yeah, exactly.
Frank McGarvey didn't try a leg, according to who?
According to James Morton.
James Morton. He's convinced there's something in it.
Yeah,
he thinks there's something in the conspiracy that St Mirren laid down to Celtic to help them win the league.
Mikey85 also says, I've got that fucking cap, man. I can't remember what cap you had on last week.
I was
week.
Wearing the maroon cap, the New York Yankees cap. Yeah. That's what I was wearing last week.
That one as well. Hello to goodluck-mx4qr, which is very catchy. The Big Scottish Football Podcast has to be the biggest load of rubbish I've listened to.
Thanks for listening.
I would actually prefer to listen to a party political broadcast than this, and I don't even vote. Vote capitalised. For no reason, really, there. So brush up on your grammar, and then you can come back. And we look forward to your comment on next week's episode, obviously. Right, lots to get through. League Cup at the weekend, obviously taking centre stage. It was the last 16. Let's start with the big shock that happened yesterday. We'll work our way backwards. So it was Kilmarnock 1, Celtic 0. And for the first time in his Celtic managerial career, Brendan Rodgers will not be winning a domestic trophy.
And Kilmarnock deserved their victory yesterday. So, a lot of Celtic fans gave me a hard time for quote-unquote making excuses for Michael Beale in regards to a new team and assembling a new team during the summer and a rebuild and all that. And I think that Brendan Rodgers had a similar issue yesterday. He was missing three of his best defenders, one of which was sold to Spain just last week. So you got no Carter Vickers, you had no Starfelt because he's gone, you had no Johnston because he's injured. So those three are out. You've then got Hatate, who's missing because of injury. You've also no got Jota, and you've no replaced him. Leo Abada's a decent player, but he's no Jota. So he's missing five of the team that won the treble last year. And he's integrating new players into that Celtic squad. So I'm not taking anything away from Kilmarnock, but what I'm saying is that Brendan Rodgers, like Michael Beale, is going to need time to put his mark on that team, especially when you've got as many injuries as he has. But Kilmarnock deserved their win.
Now, he said after the game, Brendan Rodgers, yesterday, that he was obviously disappointed and, you know, he wasn't happy with the performance.
Blamed the pitch as well. He said the pitch played a part.
He also said the pitch did play a part. Now, obviously, this is a massive bee in your bonnet and it always has been.
Yeah. No, you're going about the day. We do it enough.
Okay.
But, I mean, if you want to ask me a question about it, I'll be more than happy to, because, again, it's exploded on Twitter, this pitch. And all plastic pitches, it has gone crazy on Twitter, because I put up a tweet at halftime when it was 0-0 complaining about that pitch, and it's just exploded. I think 1.1 million people have read or been through the thread of that particular... I've lost my trail of thought here. Somebody would help me.
No, I'm quite watching. I'm quite enjoying you floundering here. This is quite good. You've lost your trail of thought.
I lost my trail of thought. I was going to say something. I don't want to swear.
Right.
Okay. That's what I was trying to do. I was stopping myself from swearing, right? Because I don't want to be one of those individuals. But it is a fucking disgrace, right, that pitch. And it's not an excuse for Celtic's overall performance, but it does play a part.
Okay. And he did say that he's looking to bring in players over the next 10 days. So a lot of chat on last night, Celtic fans saying, this is what was happening the first time around when Brendan Rodgers left. He was unhappy. Remember, they got put out by AEK Athens in the Champions League qualifiers, and he was basically like, well, you know, you've basically, you know, sold my players and then not given me the funds to replace them. Ange was obviously heavily backed in the transfer market. Now, he signed a couple of players, but in terms of what Celtic have sold, they haven't replaced them yet.
No.
And what we've got, 10 days left in the transfer window now?
Brendan Rodgers also made it clear, I think it was last week, where he said, the football department give me the players and I coach them, as if to say, I'm wiping my hands off of this. I'm basically just coaching the players that they give me. Mm-hmm. Whereas Ange Postecoglou clearly got the players that he wanted, because he dived into the market that he knows and brought the players to Celtic that have done a wonderful job in winning the trebles, etc. So I think Brendan Rodgers is wiping his hands off of what's going on behind the scenes in regards to the players that have been brought into the club. And here's the thing. I think that yesterday's result might just be a blessing in disguise. That Brendan Rodgers, deep down, be going, right, okay, that's happened. What are we going to do to remedy this issue and fix the problem? Can we get some quality in? Because Celtic do need a bit of quality, especially if they want to be challenging in the Champions League, which is just around the corner. Celtic's squad depth doesn't look particularly great. And I think that was proved yesterday. I don't think you can criticise the two centre-backs. They're new. They've just come in. They've still to learn. working as a unit together. I thought they did all right yesterday, actually, considering that Kilmarnock were battering them with high balls left, right and centre. I thought they did all right. I just think that Celtic just lacked a cutting edge, and I felt sorry for Kyogo. He was up front and there was no space in behind, and he had to come deep, drop into midfield to then run at the Kilmarnock defence. So Celtic don't seem to have a plan A or a plan B, and they hadn't learned the mistakes of Rangers. I don't know why they were trying to play neat and tidy football through the middle of that Kilmarnock defence, get it wide and get crosses whipped in. They just were not doing that, and it was food and drink to the Kilmarnock centre-backs.
I mean, you mentioned Kilmarnock against Rangers, and obviously now they've beaten Celtic as well at Rugby Park with the same scoreline. Kilmarnock have a relatively new team. They've got six or seven new players in there. They seem to have settled quite well. Drew at Tynecastle last week.
Not conceded a goal yet.
Not conceded a goal.
They've played Celtic, Rangers and Hearts, and they've not conceded a goal. And I think the stat is they've only faced two or three shots on target in three games of football.
Now, that's not all down to the pitch, you know?
Well, it's two of the three games, mate.
I know, but it's not all down to that. They went to Tynecastle and got a draw as well. I think that's a convenient excuse to say, oh, we've got loads of new players.
Stephen, we're not going to fall out over this, right? What I'm not saying that Kilmarnock only beat Celtic and Rangers because of the pitch. What I've said and always said. Well, you were suggesting that.
You're misunderstanding me here. You said that a lot of the excuses that Celtic and Rangers put forward for getting beat by Kilmarnock were, oh, we've got new players, it's a bedding in process.
Gelling, etc., etc.
So did Kilmarnock. So Kilmarnock in the game against Rangers, seven new players were making their league debut. Seven players.
But you look at like St. Marley Watkins and people like that who've all come in. They know the league. They know what they're coming into. They've played there, been there, done it, got the T-shirt.
I know, but with all due respect to Marley Watkins... let's be serious here. Celtic and Rangers are spending millions of pounds on players.
Yeah, I know.
And you're just saying, oh, well, they should have just signed Marley Watkins.
No, I'm not.
Well, no, but he knows the league. He's got there. He's got the T-shirt, apparently.
You know exactly the point that I'm making.
No,
here.
I'm
not making excuses for Celtic and Rangers, but I think, Stephen, come on. I mean, let's be honest.
That's fine. Like, if you're going to go down that road,
you make a really good point, and you're right. How have Kilmarnock been able to gel as quickly as they have and play as well as they have, and it's taken Celtic and Rangers a wee bit of time? Because let's be honest, Rangers and Celtic have not pulled up any trees since the start of the campaign.
I was going to go on to say that. I think we'll get onto Rangers in just a wee second in their match against Morton. But, you know, all of the matches, and we've said on this podcast, Celtic and Rangers have not been impressive so far this season. They've got the wins generally.
Yeah.
You know, Rangers are back on track. They got through in the Champions League.
Yeah.
Celtic obviously lost for the first time yesterday. But even before that, they've not been blown teams away.
We said that after the Ross County game with Celtic. Ross County were really good at Parkhead and were unlucky not to get something from it. I thought Aberdeen were excellent last week against Celtic, and if it wasn't for a couple of really bad mistakes, I think Aberdeen get something out of that game, and then they were poor against Kilmarnock. Celtic and the Rangers fans know they're not great right now. But as I said last week, if that's them not great right now, then God help us all when they do switch on and they do start playing well. They'll still be the top two. They'll still run away with it. They'll still hammer everybody else eventually, and they'll get their act together. But at the moment, it is a concern.
At the moment, Kilmarnock are favourites of the league. They beat Celtic and Rangers in the top three games.
By the way, no. They're favourites for the treble.
Yes, exactly.
favourites for the treble. But Hearts will stop that in the next round.
Just finally on this game, Kilmarnock specifically.
Amazing.
Brilliant start to the season.
Wow.
Derek McInnes looks like he has fight. Like last season, first season back in the Premiership after winning promotion, it wasn't an impressive promotion. It was on the last day of the season, remember?
Yeah.
They beat Arbroath on the Friday night. Last season, they just about sort of avoided the playoffs and all the rest of it with two or three games to go, which obviously would have been the aim. It does look like this season, though, Kilmarnock are really kicking on, and Derek McInnes will be aiming for a place in the top six.
100%. And you can see he's got fire in his belly. Did you see him on the touchline yesterday? And when he spoke to Viaplay afterwards, he was hoarse and he'd been screaming all day. But do you know what? He has got the players fighting for each other. They were outstanding. They were there. They were battling for everything. They're putting their bodies on the line. They outfought Celtic yesterday. And I know we're going to get to the VAR stuff in just a wee second, which might have turned the game had the little winger got a red card for his elbow on Greg Taylor. But we'll get to that in just a wee second. But I thought Kilmarnock were sensational yesterday and have been sensational since the start of the campaign. And they, for me, right now as it stands, are favourites for the sixth spot in the Premiership.
Let's spin through the rest of yesterday's results first. So Hearts 4, Partick Thistle 0. Not much resistance from Partick Thistle. A pretty impressive performance by Hearts as well. Looks like they are beginning to find their feet a wee bit.
So let me just read out the Hearts starting 11 for you. Clark, Kent. Clark Kent.
Yeah. That's unfair if you're starting Superman.
I know. I mean, it's a bit of a disadvantage.
Clark
Kent. Newenhoff, the new signing that we got from Australia. Shanklin, Rawls, Mackay, Cochrane, Sibic, Ofaya, who we got from Brighton, who scored yesterday with a brilliant header. Lowry, who got man of the match yesterday. And Vargas, our new signing up top. And then on the bench, Kingsley, Grant, Boyce, Devlin, Halliday, Forrest, Denham, and Tagawa. We have strength and depth. We have a really good squad of players there. And I haven't yet mentioned Beningame, who's still coming back to fitness as well. So Hearts have not only got a brilliant starting 11, they've got a great squad of players to choose from. They will get third, no doubt about it. That squad will get third because I don't think that Aberdeen have got the quality that Hearts have got. I don't think Hibs have got the quality that Hearts have got. So Hearts are coming on to a game. Brilliant other night there against Rosenborg. Superb against Partick Thistle, who they didn't give a kick of the ball to. And we were only in second gear. That was an outstanding performance. And Lowry, wow. Now, I've been saying for the last 2 weeks.
Was it Zico first week? It was Messi last week as well.
And he's saving Scottish football.
Right.
My thing with Lowry is, if Livingston are killing Scottish football, Lowry is saving Scottish football.
So who is he this week then?
Lowry?
Yeah.
Oh, he's Maradona.
Maradona this week.
He got man of the match yesterday, mate.
Yeah, against Partick Thistle in the League
Cup. He ran the show. They couldn't get near him.
Yeah.
He was running past them as if they weren't there. He was going through them as if he was Casper the Ghost.
Okay.
Right. He is
Maradona,
a
Casper
joy to watch. He's somebody that you spend double the money to go and see.
Okay.
Alex Lowry, man of the match yesterday, and this boy is going to be brilliant for us this season. My only concern is he'll be that good that Rangers will call him back in January.
And it's going to be Kilmarnock versus Hearts in the next round, obviously, at Rugby Park. So we'll get to the full draw just a wee second. Hibs eventually overcoming Raith Rovers by 2-1. It was Ewen opening the scoring. Callum Smith equalising for Raith Rovers. But then just a minute later, Venti getting what proved to be the winner for Hibs. So that means they are through to the next round. They're taking on St Mirren. And it's another home tie for Lee Johnson, which he'll be happy with. Pleased to get through in terms of Hibs as well. You know, it keeps their momentum. I'm going after the good result against Luzern over in Switzerland as well. So, again, into the quarterfinal.
Yeah, I would make Hibs favourites to get to semi-finals as well. I think that was a good win for them yesterday off the back of their exploits in Switzerland. A lot of people might have expected a banana skin there. But when you've got Johan in your team, you've got Boyle in your team, you're always going to create chances. And the boy Venti, he scored against Luzern at Easter Road, comes off the bench, scores again. So, yeah. As I said, and you've said, Hibs have got goals in their team and they're going to be a threat, especially in the cup competitions, one-off games, when you've got that threat up front. They could, if the draw goes right for them, they could get to a final.
Raith Rovers take on Dunfermline in the first Fife derby of the season this coming Saturday at East End Park, though. They might have to do it without Liam Dick, who was sent off in stoppage time yesterday. Yeah. Not entirely sure how the rules apply for that, so we'll need to see. But Raith Rovers have had a pretty decent start to the season as well. So that was yesterday's matches. Let's move on to Saturday. St Mirren 1, Motherwell 0.
Tight game.
Boyd Munce, we said on the show on Saturday it was going to be tight. One goal might settle, and in the end, that's what actually happened. Motherwell only had one shot. And it was obviously a stunning strike for St Mirren.
Yeah. It was a tight game.
Yeah.
I mean the first goal was always going to be key to that game. And I know that's a cliched thing to say, but in that particular game, it was always going to be the difference. And St Mirren got that goal and held on. But again, I think that St Mirren and Motherwell and Kilmarnock are three really good sides, well organised, and they're going to cause a few shocks this year.
Yeah, absolutely. St Mirren have won all their games so far this season.
Unreal.
In the league anyway. Yeah. So, and then yesterday, obviously, or Saturday in the League Cup. So as I mentioned, they play Hibs in the next round. And let's round off the games from the Saturday. It was Rangers 2, Greenock Morton 1. Now we'll get on to the VAR, the penalties and all the rest of it in just a wee second. But again,
Rangers were pish.
Rangers didn't play very well. They did enough to get through, which is all that March when it comes to cup competitions, but Morton did give them a wee fright.
They did, and I thought Morton were very good. If you're a Rangers fan, you're worried, and you're particularly worried when you're coming up against a PSV side who's scoring goals for fun right now, and they've got that Champions League qualifier this week.
He made 8 changes from the team.
Yeah, no, but that 8 changes were still very good.
Yeah.
I mean, they're very good players.
No Marley Watkins, of course, but he's Marley. Like, they missed out on him.
Yeah, so they could have got him.
They could have got him, yeah, exactly.
But, yeah, listen, as we said last week about Celtic, even though they weren't great against Aberdeen, it's all about getting the win. Yes, Rangers were poor again at the weekend, but it's all about the win. And we'll get to the VAR stuff in just a wee second. But Greenock Morton, all the plaudits go to them. I thought they were very, very good. Dougie Imrie did a job on Rangers. He's done his homework and very nearly caused one of the biggest shocks in Scottish football in a while.
Yeah, absolutely. In the end, Rangers are through to the quarterfinals, which was the aim. They take on Livingston at Ibrox in the quarterfinals, and that's after Livingston overcome a potential banana skin there. Everyone was thinking, yeah, Air United, you know, in with a chance. Ended up 2-0 to Livingston. Fairly straightforward. Aid McGeady did start for Air for the first time, and it's the fourth time in 5 years that Livingston have reached the League Cup quarterfinals, which is very impressive.
That's a good stat.
Yeah.
Is that a stat that you got, or is that a stat that somebody gave you?
That is what producer John gave me.
So that must not be true, then.
It must not be true.
Because producer John's not very good at his job, as we noticed last week.
So it was Nubley and Montano with the goals sending Livy through to the quarterfinals.
Can I just say about Joe Nubley, because people have been asking me about this on Twitter. I said at the end of last season
he was going to be joining our team in Edinburgh that began with H.
Yes.
And ended in an S.
And he's still at Livingston. And yeah, a couple of people have asked me, oh, what happened to Joe Nubley? And why is he still there? And I thought he was leaving. I still think that he'll be gone before the transfer window closes.
Okay, that's Ewen Cameron's. I think does that deserve a hot take?
Is a hot take. Give me the hot take explosion.
Yeah, I think we need a hot take explosion.
There we go. John Nubley will be leaving Livingston by the end of the transfer window.
Okay, Airdrie 3, Ross County 4 after extra time. What a match this was. So Ross County were absolutely cruising at half time, 3-1 to the good.
Yeah.
And they thought it was all wrapped up. However, Airdrie, another great comeback. It was Gallagher and O'Connor in the last 10 minutes or so. I told you Airdrie are going to shock a few people this season in the championship. They're a really decent side, and they nearly took a scalp on Saturday as well. In the end, Ross County getting the winner through Eamon Brophy, so they'll be delighted to get through the next round where they will take on Aberdeen. But what a match on Saturday afternoon between Airdrie and Ross County. And this is what it is with Airdrie. They just go for it all the time.
They've got goals in their team,
mm-hmm,
and they always cause a threat.
I said
on Saturday, on the big Saturday football show, that I thought the shock of the weekend would be Airdrie. I thought Airdrie might just cause the shock, because I didn't expect Celtic to lose. But there you go. Ross County have gone away from home and took it to extra time. Well done to Airdrie.
Yeah.
But Ross County's quality shining through. And we aim in Brophy. Good striker.
You've always got a wee chance.
Yes.
You've always got a wee chance. So, yeah, that is Ross County throughout the quarters, where they'll take on Aberdeen at Dingwall after Aberdeen won on Friday night against Stirling Albion. It was 2-1. Our colleague, Steve Cowan, was commentating for Red TV on Friday night, and he said for about 70 minutes, Aberdeen were absolutely cruising, 2-0 up.
It
was fine. It wasn't the most impressive performance, but they were getting the job done. All of a sudden, a long diagonal for Stirling Albion.
Boom.
Greg Spence scores, and for the last 15 minutes or so, it was panic stations.
Very much so. And apparently, Aberdeen were close to conceding an equaliser as well. There was a couple of occasions where Stirling Albion thought they were about to equalise. Look, again, it's all about getting through to the next round. And the Aberdeen fans on Twitter after the game were not happy with the performance. And I think that's because they've gone to Livingston and drawn 0-0, weren't they great? And even though they lost to Celtic, that's the best I've seen Aberdeen play against Celtic in 42 years. And then they go to Stirling Albion and they get their win. So I think, again, the Aberdeen fans just need to take a step back, look at the bigger picture, look at the performance against Celtic despite the defeat, and you got through to the next round of the Cup. And yes, the next round of the Cup's a difficult tie. They're away to Ross County, and Ross County are playing well right now. So I think that one is 50-50, if I'm being honest, because Ross County have got home advantage.
Okay, so that was the League Cup. So the full draw, just in case you missed it, Kilmarnock versus Hearts, Rangers, Livingston, Ross County, Aberdeen, Hibs, St Mirren. Who's making it through from that? First one, Kilmarnock, Hearts. You're obviously going to go for Hearts, aren't you?
It'll go to extra time. I think it's a tough one. It'll be really tight, but I think Hearts will just get it because of their quality.
Rangers to go through against Livingston, no, yep.
Again, so lucky Rangers getting a home draw, and they couldn't have picked a better team either. They picked Livingston.
Ross County versus Aberdeen.
Again, really tight, but I'll just give it to Aberdeen.
And Hibs St Mirren going for Hibs.
I think I'll go for Hibs
as well. The semi-final lineup, according to you and Cameron, will be Hibs, Aberdeen, Rangers and Hearts. So there we are.
And it'll be a Hibs-Hearts final.
Okay, right, fair enough. Let's drop down into the Championship. One game at the weekend, Arbroath 0, Queen's Park 1. 3-3 from Queen's Park in terms of their start to the league campaign, but they have played Arbroath twice now, and Inverness was their other match. They're also struggling as well, so read into that what you will, but Arbroath are mega struggling. They have not won in the Scottish Championship since the 31st of March.
They're gone. They're finished. That's it. Their status in the Championship will be ended at the end of the season. Gone.
Queen's Park. Do we not know?
No, because they couldn't have handpicked three better games to play at the start of the season. No, two against Arbroath and one against Inverness.
Yeah, exactly.
So you expect them to win those games.
Elsewhere in League One on Saturday, it was Edinburgh City 0, Hamilton 3. Hamilton motoring along 3-3 so far for them. So it looks like they'll be up there come the end of the season. A good win for Kelty Hearts against Alloa. 2-1. 2 wins from 3 for Kelty. Montrose suffer another defeat at home. And this time it was Cove Rangers who look like they're back on track after losing on the opening day. So 3-0 winners. And Queen of the South yet again coming from behind to win 3-1 against Annan. Annan, bottom of the table. No wins for them. And they are struggling alongside Edinburgh City at the bottom of the table. Finally, in League 2, it was Burnley Rose 1, Stranraer 1, Clyde 1, Peterhead 2, Clyde dispensing with Jim Duffy on Friday night as well.
Why?
The director of football role. I've not had a dick in.
Do you not have an insight into Clyde?
I don't have an insight into Clyde. I know that the fans are not happy at all.
Producer John's used to keeping his eye on lower league football because that's what he knows, because his team Falkirk in the lower leagues. Have you heard anything about Jim Duffy, Producer John?
I haven't, but I will look into it for you because I've got a connection at Clyde.
Okay, or a Jim Duffy connection or a Clyde connection?
Clyde connection. Clyde
and
connection.
Who's your connection at Clyde, mate?
The guy who runs the podcast.
Right, okay.
Oh, he'll have the inside scoop on that.
They're not happy, though, the Clyde fans. They are,
they're not.
Very, very much not happy. Brian McLean still in the head coach role, so I'm not entirely sure what's going on. Anyway, they got beat by 2. 2-1 by Peterhead on Saturday. Dumbarton 3-4-1. East 5-0. Steny 2. No wins for East 5 so far this season. And the Spartans have won 2-1 against Elgin City. So it is Peterhead who are... Yeah, they're top on
Yes.
Right, okay, let's move on to VAR WTF, please.
La gente está muy loca. What the fuck?
So this is the time each week where we go through all the refereeing decisions as not to cloud our reviews of the game. So we do it separately.
Yes.
Because, you know, you can get bogged down in this stuff. So VAR at the weekend was only in play in two matches, which was Rangers versus Morton and Kilmarnock against Celtic. Let's start with Rangers versus Morton. So it was a Dessers foul on Broadfoot for the penalty, and then the penalty was given. Grant Gillespie scores. Morton go 1-0 up. Any complaints there?
Right. I thought they were both very soft. Even Dougie Emery, the Morton manager, went, I thought they were both soft. Really soft. I couldn't really see where the connection was for the Kirk Broadfoot penalty.
They were both Kirk Broadfoot.
As in the one that he won.
All right, okay.
The one that he won in the box. So, yeah, that was soft. See the one at the back post when Rangers get the penalty. See if the ball isn't anywhere near Balogun. That isn't given as a penalty. I think because he does pull in the jerseys, Balogun is making his way to strike the ball towards goal. He gives the referee and VAR a decision to make. I still think it's really soft,
yeah,
personally. But see, when you do that, when you're trying to volley it or get it back across goal for a goal-scoring opportunity, you're running the risk of giving the referee no option but to give a penalty.
It was stupid from Broadfoot.
It was really stupid.
Like, he didn't even need to
because
I don't think Balogun was getting the ball.
Like no, and he kind of struck it, but it was off his toe. But he wasn't going to do anything with it.
I don't think the tug actually made that much of a difference.
No.
But you can't do that.
No.
It was stupid.
And here's the thing with Broadfoot doing that. If they'd held on for another 5 minutes,
yeah,
then the panic sets in. The Rangers fans get on the back.
Started turning as well.
Yeah. I just think it was so soon after you winning the penalty and you going 1-0 up, right? Keep it tight. Don't do anything daft for the next 5-10 minutes. And what are you going to do? You're going to do something absolutely stupid. So yeah, both penalties for me are soft. I can see why they've been given. So from a VAR perspective, I'm going to give them a tick, but only just.
Okay, yeah. I mean, I think I agree with you. I think it was... They were both soft, but they probably were both penalties.
Yeah.
Let's move on to Kilmarnock versus Celtic. The elbow on Greg Taylor.
I didn't see it at the time. I did not see that at the time. It wasn't until
it
slowed down.
That was
the point I was just going to get to. So I didn't see it at the time. And even when they showed the replay, I think they only showed it once on Viaplay, and I didn't see it then either. And then when he was getting treatment in the sidelines, and it was at the side of his head. Do you know what I thought he did? I thought that Greg Taylor was very double-jointed. Because what I thought he did, because when he slides, when he falls to the deck, his right foot goes behind his head, his back. I thought he'd actually cut himself with his own boot at the back of his head. And it isn't until you see the replay slowed down, there is an elbow there. Now, is that intentional? Only the Kilmarnock winger knows the answer to that question. But here's the thing. See if VAR does its job that day, and it really should have, because VAR should be asking the question, why is he getting blood looked at, a cut on his head, after an incident like that? So VAR have missed one there, and I genuinely believe if VAR see that and the referee goes to the screen, I think, was it Johnston, the winger? Was it the number 11? I can't remember who it was.
I can't remember who it was.
But put it this way, if VAR see that and the referee is...
Has VAR not seen that, though?
But I know, that's another question. He would have got a red card. I've got no doubt about it. If the referee's called over at the screen, he gets a red card.
And I think it was Danny Armstrong.
Danny Armstrong, there you go. And here's the other thing that's really interesting about that particular incident. So Danny Armstrong has his elbows connected with Greg Taylor. Greg Taylor needs treatment because he's bleeding. So he's off the pitch. Where does the goal come from? It comes from that side where Greg Taylor would be, because there's an overlap.
Yeah.
The centre half is clearly in his position, and the goal comes from there. So, Celtic were unlucky there, and VAR did not do their job, so they got that one wrong.
What about Haksabanovic being brought down in the box? Was that a penalty or was it not?
Right, I've argued with loads of Celtic fans about this, and there's a lot of Celtic fans that agree with me as well, but it's 50-50 for me. I think that he manufactures the contact. I think he goes looking for it. He flicks his boot out to get connection from the Kilmarnock player. Is there enough contact there for him to go down the way that he did? No. Was there enough contact there for him to act the way that he acted? No. So for me, it's not a penalty, but I think the problem is just before that, I think 2 minutes before that, he does a Cantwell outside the box. He goes looking for a penalty outside the box. He takes a dive. There's no doubt about it. And it's something that Cantwell does quite regularly, which is really annoying. He does the exact same thing. So I think because he'd done that there, when it comes to that second incident, I think his reputation has preceded him. And I think that's why they've not looked at it. Now, I spoke to two referees, Des Roach and Steve Conroy, off the back of that incident, and both of them said it's not a penalty. Not all contact in the box is a penalty. And I think what they mean by that is that there might have been contact, but there wasn't enough there for him to go down the way that he did. So I'm going to ask you the question. As a fan, are you calling for a penalty there?
Oh, 100%.
Would you want Scotland to get a penalty there?
100%.
If that's Shea Adams in the box against Spain, and he flicks his boot out, and contact is made by the Spanish defender, you would scream for a penalty?
100%.
Even though it's manufactured and you know that he's looking for it, he himself has instigated the contact.
People look for penalties all the time.
Yeah, no, but he's instigated. Is that not a form of gamesmanship?
Yeah.
So you're okay with that?
Yeah. If it's my team, yeah.
If it's not your team?
Oh, if it's not my team, then it's not a penalty. He's manufactured it, he's a cheat. But you asked me as a fan, so right. I was giving you... If I was calling it straight down the line...
It's one of them you could give.
Yeah, you've seen so many penalties like that given, and then you're sort of like, well, you can't really argue that.
I agree. It's a bit like the two penalties in the Rangers Morton game.
I don't know. I think on the balance,
would it have been soft?
Oh yeah, of course it would have been soft.
But again, you'd kind of get it as well.
Yeah,
that you would understand why
they say these things even themselves out. Of course, a season or a year or something like that. Kilmarnock in the semi-final last year.
Oh, at Hampden, where Giamakis
should have probably had a penalty. You know, it would have been soft as well.
And VAR didn't look at that.
So, listen, these things even themselves out. I do think that Armstrong should have been sent off for the...
I actually think if VAR see that, he's gone. And then that goal doesn't happen, and it might be a very different conversation today, and Celtic still might be looking for a treble. They're not. because they didn't get the rub of the green.
Okay.
I say the green. I don't know what colour that pitch was yesterday. It was glistening. It was like a mirror. Did you see it? Seeing the sunlight, you can't see what's going on. I couldn't tell who was a Celtic player or a Kilmarnock player.
Well, Celtic usually play in green and white hoops, very famously. So, I mean, that's a clue for you there.
But did you not think that pitch was glistening?
They watered it at half time.
But it was like glistening. It was hot.
But the thing is, just with the heat and that, it would have just all evaporated. So,
somebody messaged actually to say the other problem that you have with an artificial pitch that can also cause problems for the players is it smells. There's an odour.
I mean,
when the artificial pitch is being hit by sunlight, there's an odour and it can overwhelm players. Is that true?
I think that's extremely untrue. I think somebody has quite clearly taken the piss out of you there, Ewan.
I thought it was a really interesting point of view. No. I nearly Googled to find out whether or not
What's happened there. What they've obviously done is they've gone to Falkirk and just mistaken the actual smell of Falkirk for the plastic
mouth.
Pit. And that's what it is, fumes, the petrochemicals and stuff like that. So that is VAR at WTF. It will be back next week when we will have a full complement of VARs to complain and moan about and pour over next week on the show.
The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewan Cameron.
Right, every week on the show, we're going to bring out the Scottish football bin, and this season we are going to fill it every single week. Someone will nominate something to go in the said bin, and it's up to you to vote for whether it goes in or not. Last week, Ewan Cameron, or the week before, I should say, nominated plastic pitches, and then just last week, it was, who do you really support? So we had lots and lots of votes on at Big Football Scott. That's where you follow us on our Twitter page. You can vote there. You can tweet us at any time and we'll pick it up and we'll maybe mention it on the podcast the following week, obviously. And I've not actually seen the results of the poll, so this is news to me. Producer John, do you have the results of the poll?
They are on your bit of paper in front of you, Stephen.
I think you should reveal it to us.
Do you want me to?
This is a question that people get asked all the time, but who do you really support? In the bin, and I hope it does go into the Scottish football bin.
Exactly.
Who do you really support?
Okay, then.
Oh, you say you're a Hearts fan, but you're not really a Hearts fan, right. Are you? You say you're a Falkirk fan. Nobody supports that shite. Who do you really support?
Right, the results are in, gentlemen. Here we go. Stephen.
Yeah.
It's a good result for you. With 62% of the vote, excellent. The question, who do you really support, is going in the bin.
Great result. Excellent. The right result.
Yeah.
Well done, the people of At Big Football Scott, who follow us there. So
well done,
everyone. Thank you. So that is that in the bin. A wee drum roll there from John. Very excited there. So what is going in the bin this week for you, Ewan Cameron? What is this week's nomination?
Okay, so it's my turn to nominate what goes into the Scottish football bin. And it's a food item at football matches that need to go in the bin.
Okay.
Burgers.
You're putting burgers in the bin.
I'm putting burgers in the bin. They are an abomination. I have yet to see or have a burger at any football stadium in Scotland that isn't an abomination. They are an absolute disgrace. They're awful. It's like one of those burgers you get that you put in a microwave.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I'm talking
Rustler's
about?
Burger, yeah,
it's like that.
Yeah.
But with a Rustler's burger, you get some sachets of tomato sauce or something. With the things that you get at the football, they are bogging. They're not even the meat is grey.
Yeah.
The meat, I don't know what it is. You open up that roll and it's just a bit of greyness sat there looking at you.
So
I'm going to see burgers at a football stadium. Forget it. Pies, sausage rolls, Haribos. I'll have a Haribo. I like a Haribo.
A football match.
Wine gums.
Yeah.
Like wine gums.
Fair enough. Yeah.
I like a sports mixture.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I'll take more sports mixtures because the football stadium.
Because you're an old man and that's what old men do.
No.
That's because what they do. They take these to the football.
No, because sometimes they don't have sports mixtures at the stadiums I go to.
Okay, right.
I would have a pie, I'd have a sausage roll, some Haribo's, wine gums, and I'd have a sports mixture. I also like a packet of crisps.
Mm-hmm.
That's not bad.
What about anything to wash it down? Juice?
A Capri Sun.
Capri Sun?
And do you know why I have a Capri Sun?
Uh-huh.
Because See, bottles and cans, nah. Like Capri Sun, you get that wee plastic lid.
Yeah.
And you can screw it back
on. Right, okay, yeah, right enough, yeah.
Yeah, so... So a Capri Sun is perfect for me, and that's it. That's all the food items you need. But when you try to go exotic and offer something that's a wee bit different...
What about like a chicken curry pie? Well, something like that, a doner kebab pie.
You know, see, there was... Who was it?
So you need to be specific here.
I went to Hampden and I got a haggis and steak pie or something, and it was boggin', it was too dry. There was no gravy.
Right. Okay, but that sounds like an individual pie problem as opposed to the concept of a haggis and steak pie, which I've had before and enjoyed many times.
Okay.
So are we zoning in? You need to be specific.
A burger.
Here. Burgers.
Burgers full stop. Because it's never going to be as
burgers
good.
Burgers at the football full stop, not like burgers full stop.
No. I like a McDonald's. I like a Burger
King.
Okay,
that's why I was just trying to put it
down. I like a Five Guys.
So... But football burgers in the bin.
Football burgers in the bin.
Okay.
That has to happen.
At Big Football Scott, you can vote now and we will bring you the result next week on the podcast.
What about you? Would you want the burger in a Scottish football bin?
Nah, it wouldn't be my first choice, but sometimes
it's a food item.
I know, exactly.
I'm just talking about a food item. Would you put a burger from Scottish football in the bin? It's bogging me. It's minging. It's boofing.
What if you got a really good one?
They're not.
Right. Because you've had all the burgers in Scottish football. there's not a burger that you have not had in Scottish football.
Can I ask producer John here, who's obviously been around all the lower leagues, being a Falkirk fan?
Yeah.
You've obviously been to many stadiums, mate, following your pish team in that pish league. Have you had a burger and what did you think?
In all my years of going to football, I've only ever had pies at the football. I've never strayed away from the pie.
Yeah.
I've never went, apart from at Dunfermline actually, they do the Bridies at Dunfermline.
Exactly.
They're very, very good at Dunfermline. Yeah, exactly. That's the only good thing about Dunfermline.
I'm not a fan of the Bridie.
Yeah, but I've never strayed away from a pie. But I guess it's a question for the listeners. Is there a good football burger out there?
Yes, exactly. Good point, John. So if you completely disagree with Ewan Cameron's football burgers in the bin, please provide evidence to suggest otherwise. If there is a good burger somewhere in Scottish football, please let us know. Yeah. It's at Big Football Scott. We'll get the vote on for that. And we need to move on because we're rapidly approaching the time for our conspiracy theories. So did man land on the moon?
I really do have my doubts.
Right, okay.
But I genuinely do have my doubts.
Is Tupac still alive?
I saw the autopsy picture, so I don't think he is.
Is every referee a Rangers supporter?
I think a lot of them are.
Okay. That's just some of the most famous conspiracy theories in the world. But Ewan...
What, Rangers referees?
One of the big ones.
They're debating it in the United States of America.
100%. You've put your trench coat back on.
Yes, I have.
And every week, we're going to dive into a different conspiracy theory from the files of Scottish football and beyond. Ewan, what have you been investigating over the last wee while?
I am the Mulder of Scottish football.
Yes.
I've been delving deep into the darkness that is Scottish football conspiracies. So this week, we are not going to concentrate on one particular conspiracy because I have been through the big Scottish football podcast Twitter page and we got...
A bin fire in many ways.
It's a bin fire. So what I've done, I've picked out, I think, 7 different types of conspiracies.
Right.
Right?
Okay.
And I'm just going to fly through these.
Right, okay.
And then out of the 7... I would like you to choose which one we are going to investigate in great detail next week.
Right. Okay, all right. I'll do that. Right.
From Conzo, Chris Boyd played professional football.
I mean, Chris Boyd is what? The record goal scorer?
It's one of these conspiracies. Did it really happen?
I think it did, yeah.
Or is it a figment of our imagination?
No, I remember Chris Boyd being a prolific goal scorer.
Was it on FIFA?
No.
No. Football manager?
No.
From Sober Dad, Ewan Cameron is a Hearts fan. Do we want to investigate that?
No, because remember, we put in the bin last week who do you really support, so we can't do that. So that's how those
to Sober are. Dad, if you're watching on YouTube.
He was giving a V signs for the people listening.
Yeah. No, not for the people, just for Sober Dad.
Just for Sober Dad.
I know him.
But to the people listening.
Yeah. Right. Oh, sorry. From Jerry Taylor, friend of the show.
Yep.
Celtic signed the wrong Bangura by accident. I don't know if that's true. Is that true?
I don't think that's true. No, it's not true. No.
There was another Celtic fan who replied to him and said it was.
That doesn't make it true.
But maybe it's one to investigate.
Okay.
Could maybe even get him on.
Yeah.
From Leicester Crest. What a name. Leicester Crest. My theory is that Celtic purposefully lost to Hibs at Easter Road towards the end of the 2017-18 season. And he believes this for one reason and one reason only. Had they won that game at Easter Road, they would have won the league. And the reason they let Hibs win is because they wanted to win the league against Rangers the following week, which they did.
Okay.
That's a good one, that. Did they purposely go out their way to lose to Hibs to win the league against Rangers? That's what Leicester thinks.
Okay.
From Michael, this is a really good one. This one might be a good one to investigate. Michael says, Scotland played the USSR.
Yep.
In a meaningless friendly in 1967, 2 weeks before the European Cup final. Scotland played 6 Lisbon Lions in this meaningless game, with a 7th coming on as a sub. Now, what I think Michael is getting at here is that the SFA and the Scotland manager conspired to knacker the Celtic players or to get injured and stop them from winning a European Cup.
Okay.
That's what I think he's suggesting. He's saying there's a conspiracy around 7 Lisbon Lions playing a meaningless international ahead of the European Cup final 2 weeks later.
Right. Well, what I would say is it was 2 weeks before the game.
Yeah, but you can pick up an injury which can last you for 3 weeks.
You can pick up an injury in any game.
Or training. Okay. But again, I didn't know that. Did you know that? No. It's an interesting one. So that's from Michael. From Crazy Horse. Behind this anonymous account that is Crazy Horse, I am a grade 1 Scottish referee. I spend my days with my fellow colleagues plotting Celtic's downfall.
Okay. I don't think that's true.
Okay. From Jay. Just Jay.
Yeah.
With a Scotland flag as an emoji thing. Hanlon and Stevenson will never retire.
From Hibs.
It feels like that they have been around forever.
They have.
They're like the Benjamin Button of Scottish football.
They keep going.
They do keep going, like the Duracell Bunny. Mm-hmm. They just never run out of steam.
Okay, what else we got?
From Wee Baz, cup draws, all of them are rigged.
I think that's interesting. I think we've got a winner.
Okay.
Because I know how we can probably get to the bottom of that.
All right. Okay. So you want me to investigate that next week?
Yes.
Okay, wait. Just wait. James Quinn, why do PSG only play at night?
That's what I've seen that before on stuff as well. PSG only play at night. I mean, they don't. But they don't. They just... it's because they're shown
TV
on the telly.
Money, exactly, right. So. That's a great question.
Yeah.
And one final one here from Mr. Shade. Michael Beale is Pedro Caixinha in disguise.
I don't think so.
Pull that mask off like Scooby-Doo.
Okay.
So which one we doing?
I think we go for the rigged cup draws. Okay. I think we go for that because I think that's easy enough to either prove or disprove.
Okay, I'll investigate that for you next week. I do like the Bangura one. That's an interesting one. That was a bit like, was there not somebody down south who got fooled into signing a player? Was it not Southampton?
It was Graham Souness. He signed someone.
That's right. Yeah. I do like the Bangura one though. I might have to wee look into that one as well. Right. But I'll just do it personally.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'll make a report back to you. But I'll do the cup draws.
Let's do the cup draws. And the reason I think we could do that is because we know people who have done Scottish Cup draws.
We do. Exactly. We could get them on the phone. Have you felt a hot ball?
Exactly.
Have you felt an ice ball? Oh, can I just say, by the way, as we're talking about cup draws, see that Viaplay cup draw yesterday?
Uh-huh.
Could they have got the balls any bigger?
They were large, weren't
they? They were large. They couldn't even stir them in the pot.
Yeah.
I mean, the balls are too big for the pot they were in.
That's maybe easier to rig. You can't stir them. That's what I'm
saying. They're all positioned in a certain way.
Exactly.
But you think Michael Stewart would give us a home draw, eh?
Yeah.
But there again, he fell out with Craig Levine, didn't he?
I know. Right, let's move on to the Legends Lottery, shall we?
It
was Ewen Cameron trying to get Thomas Rogne, who played with Celtic. How did you get on, Ewen Cameron?
Right. Well, you boys, when I say you boys, I mean you and producer John.
Yeah.
Know that I have worked my ass off to try and get Thomas Rogne on the phone.
Right, so have you got him?
Well, let me just give you the running of events led to the point where we're at right now. So I sent, what was the team he played for?
Helsingborgs, is it?
Yeah. That team, where are they for again? Norway.
Yeah, from Sweden.
Okay. So I contacted the PR team, the media people at, what was the team?
Helsingborgs.
And this is the email that I sent. Good afternoon, my friends. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to
Don't do it in that accent. it's not one of your better accents.
No, I was thinking of the Swedish chef from the Muppets.
Ah, yeah. No.
My name is Ewen Cameron, and I work for the biggest radio station in Scotland and one of the most popular podcasts ever in the history of podcasts. Radio Clyde, Radio 4. I have been set a challenge to find and interview Thomas Rogne. Would it be possible to set up a 10-minute interview with Thomas on the phone at some point? Thanking you in advance, Ewen Cameron. So I sent that to three different people mm-hmm. over 3 days, and I didn't get a reply. I didn't even get a bounce back or nothing.
Okay.
I then got a phone number for the media department. I then called them on Friday.
Yeah.
Friday afternoon at 2 p.m. Called them at Friday, and I got an answer machine thing.
Okay.
But I think it was an answer machine thing because I couldn't understand what it was, what they were saying to me or what to do.
Okay, so did you leave a message? Or
I did leave a message. And I went...
Nobody got back to you.
And I just went, hey, Ewan here, and I want to Thomas Rogne.
Thomas Rogne.
And they don't go back to me. I did leave my number as well.
Luckily, we do have that number lined up right now. So we're going to phone them.
What, the number that I dialed?
Yes. So Helsingborg's PR department, hopefully, will be able to speak to them. John, do we have them lined up, ready to dial?
Here we go.
See, told you. It's going to go answer phone. Why are the rings so spaced apart?
Hej, du har kommit till Midhatt. Lämna gärna ett meddelande så ringer jag upp så snart jag kan.
Hello. It's Ewen Cameron here from Radio Clyde looking for Thomas Rogne. Thank you, bye.
Okay. Right, well, that's... probably caused some sort of diplomatic incident there, so that was good. So we're not getting Thomas Rogne, no.
See, I told you, you get answer phone. Okay. I don't know what you said. Maybe said we've changed our number.
Wait, if you spin it, be like that.
Right, can you see the wheel? I'll bring it further into shot here. Right, so there you are. There's the wheel.
Maybe one day we'll get a legend.
At least I tried, right? But does anyone know what they said in that voicemail? Because it could have been saying we've moved
somebody's,
to another...
If somebody's Swedish, please get in touch. Abig Football Scott. Here we go.
Who's it landed on?
On Jose Katongo!
Yes!
It's landed on Jose Katongo!
We're going to have somebody on next week, yes!
Yes, he's in Hamilton! He's in Hamilton!
He needs to fix that!
We're spun the wheel and it's there! Get
him! Amazing!
He better not be on holiday!
Oh, God.
He better not be on holiday!
Right, okay. He won't be on holiday. He'll be fine.
Get him! The kids will be at school. Of course, he'll not be on holiday.
Exactly. Right, let's fire on to our quiz then to round off the show. while John's getting that set up, just very quickly.
Yeah.
Ewen Cameron. Oh, we've got the music already. But just very quickly before we get into the quiz, want to speak about the European games this week. Just one word answers.
Okay, turn that music off and start it again, mate, because you're too quick with the buttons. Shit at what you do.
So let's
see, I'm brilliant at what I do. I'm too quick.
Rangers versus PSV. First leg at Ibrox. PSV beat Vitesse Arnhem at the weekend by 3-1.
And away from home as well.
Away from home.
They were 1-0 down and came back to win 3-1.
So are Rangers...
No.
I'm going to ask you two questions. Are they going to win on Tuesday?
If they do, it'll be narrow.
And are they going to get through the tie?
No.
Okay, let's move on to Hearts. They're playing Pauk on Thursday at Tynecastle. Pauk won 3-0 yesterday in the league. Are Hearts going to win on Thursday?
Yes.
Are they going to win the tie?
If we take a 2-goal lead in the second leg, we go through. If it's a 1-0 lead, it'll be very close.
Let's move on to Aberdeen playing BK Häcken. Häcken won 3-2. They are second in the league, in the Swedish league, just a point behind Elfsborg, who are top. They won 3-2 at the weekend.
Is that who Rogne plays for?
No, that's Elfsborg.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
Not Helsingborg.
Okay.
So Häcken are second in the Swedish top flight. Aberdeen taking them on. The close. First leg is over in Sweden.
Great opportunity for them.
Do you think they'll win?
If they win that tie, they're in the Europa League.
Do you think they'll go through the tie?
The second leg at Pittodrie, I think Aberdeen will go through.
Okay, Doug. And Hibs, I should have done this earlier because they're playing on Wednesday night at home against Aston Villa, who absolutely destroyed
Everton yesterday.
Everton 4-0 at Villa Park yesterday. John McGinn opening the scoring as well. First leg at Easter Road. Are they winning the game at Easter Road?
No. I actually messaged you yesterday. I feel sorry for Hibs. Not I feel sorry for Hibs. I fear for Hibs. But do you know what?
Yeah.
Treat Wednesday night like it's a one-off game cup final. Win that game and the Hibs fans will be ecstatic. It'll be amazing. It was a bit like when Hearts played Liverpool. We kept it to 1-0 at Tynecastle. We went to Anfield, we went 1-1.
Mm-hmm.
Took it to extra time. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you never know, but you expect Villa to win. And listen, they always knew that if they were going to get through, they were going to play Villa. That's their cup final. Go and enjoy it. You're playing against a Premiership side. It'll be brilliant. But I want Hibs to go through, but they won't.
Let's do the shootout then. Let's go for it. Hit the music, producer John. Myself and Ewen Cameron are very competitive, and we thought we should bring that to the fore this season with a friendly quiz we call the shootout. Each of us will receive 5 questions in a penalty shootout style, taking it in turns to answer, with the victor getting the bragging rights for the week. I am winning by 2-0 so far this season.
Yep.
There's been a slight twist though, because we have the Joker card and you can hit the top bin, and that means that question is worth 2 points, but of course that question is harder. So we need a quiz master. We have our contestants, myself, Stephen Mill, him, you and Cameron. Let's introduce producer John, the quiz master. Take
Hi
out
there, how Hi are you there. Doing?
Hi,
yeah,
I'm very well, very well.
Fantastic. Right. Go, you flip the coin to see who wants to go first.
Yes.
Well, flip it this time and you can call it.
Okay, I'll go heads.
Oh.
Heads it is, and I will go second.
You'll go second, so Ewen is going to go first. Fantastic. Here we go then, Ewen. Your first question on the shootout. What former Scotland and Hamilton midfielder retired from football the other week? What former Scotland and Hamilton midfielder retired from football the other week there? I've made it easy for you.
Scotland and Hamilton?
That's very, very...
So you retired?
I know he's not at Crystal Palace anymore. Is it him? I didn't think he'd retired. Is he? He's a bit young to retire, is he not? I'm going to have to say it's the only one I can think of, because the other boy is at Celtic, but he's Irish. I'm going to go with James McArthur. Get in!
There you go, you.
Get in!
Point to you, it was James McArthur.
Is he actually retired? Retired?
Yep.
Retired the other week there.
Okay.
Yep, there you go. 1-0. Ewan, Stephen, your question. What nationality is Celtic goalkeeper Benjamin Siegrist?
He's Swiss.
Nice and easy.
Wow. I would have gone Danish.
You'd have been wrong.
Just as well, Stephen went second, Ewan.
Yeah.
Right, Ewan, you should know this one. Who wore the number 9 shirt for Rangers for 3 seasons after Umar Sadiq? Remember Umar Sadiq?
After Umar Sadiq?
After Umar Sadiq, who got the number 9 jersey at Rangers?
I think that's solid. I've not got a Scooby, but it's not my question, so I don't care.
You genuinely don't know?
No.
Who was the number 9 after Umar Sadiq?
The answer's very obvious when you hear it.
Stop! Stop saying things, John!
He needs
John.
Help, Stephen, come on.
You don't want down. Help, because all if I win this quiz, I was going to go, could you go help me, John?
Right, come on, Ewan, just say something. We've got our life to go on.
Is it Kenny Miller?
A bash on the save! Can I have a guess, John?
Go for it, Stephen.
Is it Jermaine Defoe?
It is Jermaine Defoe,
oh,
there
shit.
You go. Right.
Shit.
She's behind already, Ewan.
Sharp.
Right, if I get this.
Yeah, if you get this. Yeah. Okay. Ray McKinnon is the current manager of what side?
Forfar Athletic.
Oh, I don't believe this. I genuinely don't believe this.
You wouldn't have got that.
I would have got that.
Would you really?
All of a sudden, you can look into my brain and know what I know.
Yeah.
I can look into my brain and know what I know.
Right.
Right, okay, Ewan. Grant Gillespie is the captain of which Scottish Championship team? Grant Gillespie is the captain of which Scottish Championship team?
I don't know anything about the pishy lower leagues.
I'm not even going to say what I was about to say there, but it's fine. Just give an answer. Which Scottish Championship team does he captain? And we can all move on. And then I can win the quiz again. So, come on.
You honestly,
I know the answer, so it's fine.
I know the answer. That's because you're used to talking about the pishy lower leagues. Because I'm a Premiership
Scottish
club
manager. The big Scottish football podcast covers every single league,
apart from the Lowland League, and
apart from the Lowland League and the Highland League.
We don't talk.
What's his name?
Grant Gillespie.
Grant, and it's a Championship club.
Aye,
come on.
I'm going to go for.
Did I say last week that was wrong? Could, no, it's not Queens.
Queens aren't even in the championship, mate.
Yeah. Queen of the, Queen's Park.
All right, but you mean Queen of the South. No, right, come on, hurry up.
I just hate that you're sitting there knowing just, what the
just,
answer
just
is.
Just say a team.
I'm going to go with Partick.
And Marshall has saved!
Such a spoonhead. Yes. You're such a spoonhead.
How?
Because Grant Gillespie is the captain of Morton. He scored the penalty for Morton on Saturday, and I mentioned that about 20 minutes ago.
I need to start listening.
Yeah. Stephen!
Yeah.
Which Scottish Premiership stadium translates from Gaelic as dung heap? Which Scottish Premiership stadium translates from Gaelic as dung heap?
Is it Pittodrie?
Yeah.
So I'm winning 3-1.
3-1.
I'm
you're going to go top bin.
I'm top bin question, please.
Right, top bin for you.
To go 3-3.
But bear in mind, if you get this wrong, you're out. So what?
Yeah, do you not think I can do mathematics? No. I know how to work things out in my head sharp.
I'm sure. Right, okay. So it's a bit of a risk for you. You could probably just.
I'm going top bin. Let's just
right,
do
okay.
it.
Well, all right, okay. Right. In what year were Partick Thistle formed? Nice and easy. In what year were Partick Thistle formed?
I feel like I'm getting skewered every week.
That's the top end question.
The top end questions are harder.
Exactly.
You know that.
Is it on the badge? I think it might be on Thistle's badge.
Can I phone a friend?
No.
Can I phone a friend?
Let's go
phone Cat.
I won't even give you a clue.
No.
No, I won't give you a clue. I want to make it a bit competitive, Stephen, you know.
No, please. I don't need your help.
Okay,
I don't
okay,
need your charity.
Don't need my help. Don't need my charity. Fine.
Do you know this?
Yeah.
Oh,
I mean, just because I've googled it there. I would never have got this.
I'm going to go for 18 something.
Right.
18.
It's a good start.
18. Is there a 7 in there by any chance? Possibly. 7 something. 75, 6, 7, 8, 9, or 1, 2, 3, 4.
What are you going for?
I'm going to go for 75. 6.
What's your final answer?
What's your final answer?
4, 5, 6, 4!
1874. Is that your final answer?
No. I'm going to go... I'm going to go for 76.
Final answer.
Yes.
I can't believe he pulled that out of the bag! I can't believe he's pulled that out of the bag! Unbelievable. Stephen, back to you.
3-3. This is your fourth question, though.
Motherwell striker Mika Berith is currently on loan from which club?
Absolutely no idea.
What's his name?
Mika Berith. Is it Berith? Berith. Yeah. Berith. Berith. Berith, I think.
I'll go for Southampton.
And Marshall has saved!
He is on loan from Arsenal.
Right, okay.
Oh, wow, so it's 3-3 going to the final question.
3-3. It's a shootout here.
Here we go.
Right, Ewen.
Yeah.
At what club did Ryan Christie start his professional career?
Ryan Christie.
Uh-huh. Stephen knows this one.
Is it that easy?
Aye. It really is.
Because he worked with his dad, but was he with somebody else before he worked with his dad? I'm... To take the lead, I'm going to go in for this.
Got that. Right, Stephen.
You need this, mate. You can go that. Top bin to win it outright.
That's what I'm considering.
You're considering the top bin to win it outright.
Top bin to win.
Or
to lose. Or to lose.
What happens if we draw? What if he gets it?
That's a tie break question.
Okay.
Or do I take my chances in the tie break? I'm going to take my chances in the tiebreak. I'll just go for the normal question.
Right, okay. Which was the only major domestic honour Derek McInnes won as Aberdeen manager?
He won the League Cup.
Oh, wow.
In 2014.
There
we go. Against Inverness in the final, they beat them on penalties.
That means we go to a tiebreak.
Is this one question for the both of us?
Yep.
Oh, God.
Right,
here we
okay.
go.
Do we need, what do we need to do here? Write our
you,
answers.
You just give me your answers verbally, right?
Okay.
But can we write them down so we're not
cheating?
You
can write them down, so you just at like and count down, yeah, okay. So we can check your working. Okay. Okay. Here's your tiebreak question. Closest two wins.
Closest two?
Yeah. Okay. Since the first ever World Cup, how many individual countries have competed in the tournament overall? Since the first World Cup, how many individual countries have competed in the tournament overall?
So 1930 was the first World Cup. Overall?
Yeah.
Well, is there something like 179 countries on the planet? And a lot of them have just been newly formed as well. So in the early day, there wouldn't have been that many. There wasn't
I like how you're explaining your working here, Ewen. That's what they do in all the quiz shows now. When you ask a question, you have to explain your working. It really annoys me. You can't just give an answer on a quiz show these days.
No, I've got to think about it, mate. It's a really tough question, that.
Stephen's got his answer, yep.
Have you written down an answer?
Mm-hmm. Not yet.
Stephen's doing some maths here. Two, carry the one.
I think it's something like 179 or 180 for the countries on the planet. But then you look at the qualifiers, the teams that eventually get there, it's always the same countries there or there's about. On the odd occasion, you'll get a wee surprise. It'll get to the World Cup, like a Jamaican, play people like that. Iran, Costa Rica over the years. You just think that those nations, they get there once in a while. Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates got there once. That's a really good question. I can't wait to get the answer, but I need to win it.
I've written down my answer.
Have you written it down?
Yeah. I'll show it to the camera.
I'm going to go for that.
Right, okay. Both show your answers to the camera so we can just double check that and then say the answer.
I've gone for 65.
65 says Stephen Mill. Ewen, how...
I'm showing it to the camera as well, and I've gone for 74.
The answer.
It's so close.
It's quite close. The actual answer is 80, which means the streak is over. Ewen Cameron has won the shootout. Stephen Mills' whitewash for the season is over, everyone. Everyone, he's went for the top bit, he's fluked it. And he's actually won.
What a week for Heart of Midlothian Football Club. Here I am in the heart strip in the baseball cap, and I have won the shootout by 5-4. Get it right up, yay! Thank you. Thank you. Thank
right. you. Let's end the show, shall we, John? I think it's the only thing for it. There we are. Thank you very much for listening to the Big Scottish Football Podcast. Thank you for watching as well on YouTube. You can watch back anytime. Just make sure you follow Clyde 1 SSB on YouTube, or you can follow us on Twitter at Big Football Scott. Remember, you get us in all your podcast places, all the usual providers. Give us a follow. Give us a big, fat, juicy 5 stars as well if you're feeling generous. Get your shouts in as well for conspiracies and our vote for Scottish football in the bin. Burgers at Scottish football. Do they deserve to remain? It's all up to you. But we will be back next week for another episode of the Big Scottish Football Podcast. We've been Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody. Love you.